of interest? Would you not mean? No? Fine. Minutes of the last meeting. Some of the two members. Thank you, Ann. And Simon. Thank you. Executive key decisions on delegated powers are noted. Okay?
Yeah.
Thank you. And then we move on straight away to item number four, the Hoheid Golf Resort. I will introduce this to you now. Oh, sorry. I've just been informed that there's an item on the agenda, which is item number nine, where people have to be away. Mona, would you like to come forward? And I think we'll skip yours first. Item number nine, which is cumulative impact on public health scrutiny review.
Yeah, and thank you, thanks George for letting me address this morning, but also for moving up the agenda to accommodate my programme later in the day. This report was presented, has been presented for People's Scrutiny Committee, but it's the result of a task and finish panel that was initiated following discussion of a meeting of the former coordinating committee, during which Councillor Paul Hayes made the observation that Wirral's got a problem both in terms of public health and with crime and disorder related to excessive alcohol consumption. And the question was asked, are the existing policies to help reduce the impact of this sufficiently robust? And if they are they applied rigorously enough? We established a task and finish group to address that, and the objectives were to understand the profile for Wirral, for the prevalence and density of licensed premises, to understand the impact of excessive use of alcohol on the health of people living in Wirral, and to examine the powers, policies and initiatives available to the council to mitigate against the negative impact of high levels of alcohol consumption. Over the period that evidence was gathered, the panel heard from officers from planning, licensing, police, public health, and as the objective was to address public health issues around lifestyle, we included fast food as a contributory factor to the well-documented negative impact which most seriously affects people living in areas of high deprivation. We didn't look at betting shops, though we did recognise that the density of these in some areas was also damaging to the lives of some people. I'd like to thank all those officers who contributed to the information gathering, and also Patrick Torpey and Mike Callum, scrutiny support officers who supported our work and were extraordinarily helpful in doing that. The questions we asked were, how can the consumption of the most damaging high-strength alcohol be reduced? How can people be encouraged to eat more healthily and reduce the reliance on unhealthy fast food? And are the existing policies robust? If not, what can be done to strengthen them? And can they be implemented to maximum effect? In total, we made seven recommendations which are detailed in the report and they centre around strengthening the way public health issues are included in both local and national planning and licensing policies. We did hear of some excellent initiatives that local businesses are being encouraged to sign up to on a voluntary basis, such as an agreement to stop selling the most damaging high-strength alcohol through the Reduce the Strength campaign, and to address poor diet through the Takeaway for a Change and Eat Well World campaigns, which work with parents, children and retailers to encourage healthier diets. And we'd like to see this work carried on with vigour. We would like to see the work to improve these aspects of public health supported by stronger working relationships that currently exist between the departments and the establishment of a cross-departmental working party which reports to the Health and Wellbeing Board to carry this work forward. We were dismayed that there is no consideration for public health in licensing regulations, and we'd like the council leadership to press for such an objective to be included in the city region, and the city region to add its influence to that of the Local Government Association and Directors of Public Health for greater consideration to be given to public health at a national level. We'd like to see a refreshed licensing policy document for Wirral which seeks to address the objectives of the Wirral Plan. And though by the conclusions report we did understand that cumulative impact policies were only one tool which can be used, we would like to see them used where appropriate as they haven't been to date. In relation to planning policy, we did conclude that there was scope to go further than has been the case to date, and to follow examples of local authorities such welcome the fact that people are living longer, but we know that the gap between life expectancy, which exists between people living in the more affluent areas of this borough and those living in the most deprived areas, is a massive challenge for us. We want people to live longer, but we want those lives to be lived and enjoyed in good health. In conclusion, I'd like to thank my colleagues, Councillor Phil Gilchrist and Paul Hayes, and also Councillor Janette Williamson, who did a lot of the work for us in the early part of the report. And thanks again for giving me time.
Thank you, Laurie. Cabinet, any questions of Amoya? Yes.
It's not a question, it's an observation. This is a shows that when Wirral works together, it works at its best. Remember the Take Away for Change campaign, which has run through the Trade and Standards, won a national award the year, is it last year? Last year. And Nicky Crawford, who works over there, has done some fantastic work with school. This report underpins all of that, and I welcome it, and you know, I think it's great work.
Thank you.
I can't wait to see everybody who's involved.
Seen some of the figures, you know, in that, for example, an estimated sort of 66,000 people who are obese on Wirral, with an estimated 97,000 overweight in that. And thank you for bringing out about, I mean, the year six children, Wirral has some of the most overweight. So I think we need to look at that very, very carefully. And, you know, I would be targeting well before sort of primary, secondary school level, primary school level, you know, the shops around there, because I see what young children are doing in various areas. So highlighting that was really excellent for me.
Yes, Tony, you're right about primary school age. There's been some really good work done in some of the primary schools, particularly in the area around this. One of the most worrying things was there was a really high proportion, I can't remember the exact figure, so I wouldn't like to put a figure to it, but a really high proportion of children below in primary school age have fast food every day. Every day. And that is really upsetting.
Just to echo what everybody else has said about it being a great piece of work, and I think you made a really, really valid point then about this joint approach and how we need to get licensing and planning involved. Because it is about a concerted effort, isn't it, across the piece, which is going to change. And a lot of it, we can do a lot of groundwork, we can set up a lot of systems, but if planning and licensing are just allowing these outlets to go ahead, whether they're alcohol related, whether they're food related, then it won't make a heap of difference, will it? So I think that's really valid, and certainly, as you said about the leadership, we will take that to Phil and ask him to take it forward.
As it currently stands,
city region.
I'm sorry. Yeah. As it currently stands, public health cannot be presented to licensing as an objection to licensed premises. It can't be taken into consideration. And that is one massive thing that could be changed.
Yeah. Well, can I thank you Phil and Paul and Janette?
And Janette.
Sorry, Janette, I'm almost speaking, I'm sorry.
I'll just like anyone else. Well, firstly, thank you, Moira. I did take part in a lot of those disputes and at the times, and it's cross-party scrutiny as well, which is really positive. I was there at the People's Committee when it was presented, and we did get cross-party support. So thank you for presenting this welcome video on behalf of the panel under Tough Work. As Cabinet colleagues will see from the report, I took part in a particular piece of scrutiny work and found the experience reinforced my belief that Council should take every action to reduce the impact of alcohol and unhealthy foods in our communities. We know that many of the health inequalities that exist in our communities are linked to alcohol and poor diet, but it's often the most challenged communities that are exposed to the greatest risks. I'm pleased to say that Appendix 2 shows that many of the actions of the review are already being worked on. Reducing the strength, as you mentioned, is a really fantastic initiative and it's really popular. We have it well, we're all at Take Away for Change, as was mentioned by Ben there, and they're continuing to gain engagement with businesses, schools and fast food outlets. And we've started pilot work to develop High Streets in Our Communities initiative. We've agreed an approach to introduce cumulative impact policy in areas where there's evidence to justify this.
led the work to develop a Cheshire and Merseyside approach to addressing licensing issues. So I welcome it. I ask the cabinet to approve the recommendations, and I sincerely hope that in time public health will be given equal consideration when it comes to licensing and planning with the other objectives are. It's absolutely vital that we keep our residents safe, we keep them healthy, both mentally and physically, and this is a real tool in our arm. So thanks again, Mother.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you, Phil and Paul and Janette, for a very comprehensive report within the removal by the council. And in doing that, can I make the recommendation the council approves the contents and recommendations for the cumulative impact of the Cllr Ann review, and the cabinet supports the officer's response to the recommendations outlined in the report. That agreed. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Back to beginning again.
Generation of significant annual revenues to the
council in the form of business rates. Roughly 315,000 per annum and council tax of 580,000 per annum. 4.5 million over 5 years when it is completed. Reclamation of 67 areas of former landfill land and enhanced environment. And cabinet's recommendation for the potential benefits to Wirral of this project, I move the recommendations in this report to enable the project to proceed to the next stage. And can I also, in the recommendations bullet point two, can I defer that for further for a further cabinet report on bullet point two of the recommendations. Does that mean cabinet, any other questions to comment on?
Most appropriate
that the revised corporate risk management policy be formally accepted.
Agree.
Thank you. Move to item six. Okay, Stuart. At the last council meeting, Stuart, you put up a notice of motion. It has been asked to come in front of cabinet today, so first of all, welcome you and give you the opportunity to speak to the cabinet. Thank you.
Thanks, maximising residents' buy-in to that element of the proposals, because there is reluctance even to that idea out there. There's no link, however, between promoting the capture of food waste and reducing the capacity of the green bins. Two completely different issues. And there's a lot been said about tonnage of the various waste streams, and the food waste is estimated to make up 40% of the weight of a bin. That may or may not be true, I've no reason to doubt it. But it's got nothing to do with the space available in a bin for waste. In fact, when pressed on it, it's estimated that in fact food waste takes up just 10% of the volume of a bin. The two options that, that currently you've been consulting on, a smaller bin will mean a loss of 40% of space, 3 weekly collections will mean a loss of 30%. So both options, remove from people who fully fill their green bin capacity, families for the most part, removes around about a third of the space after food waste has been taken into account. People understand this and ask what will happen to the waste that won't fit in, and most are afraid that it'll end up fly-tipped or overflowing bins, etc. I don't understand why the council wants to make life harder for families. I'd ask today to just indicate to officers who are still pulling together the business plan case that they'll hopefully present to you shortly, that you're minded to pursue only the food waste collection changes and to await some further work on the impact of that before considering any other changes to collection measures. I'd also ask the cabinet, which is reflected in the notice of motion, to look again at how those plastics that can't come certainly collect small pots and trays. Can we work with them? They appear to have a market. Can we work with them? People are incredulous of the council statement about wanting to increase recycling, whilst we're not accepting recyclables in the recycling bin. In addition, people obviously raise the fact that we charge for the collection of recyclable green waste. I mean, that act alone took 4% of our recycling rates. I had an email yesterday, again, brought to my attention that a lot of flatted properties only use communal bins. Everything goes in the communal bin. There's no attempt to separate out recyclables. What can be done about that? I'm not giving you an answer to that. I'm suggesting that we have expertise within the council that could potentially look at increasing recycling rates without making life harder for families. For many people, members, you'll be aware, the only service that people perceive that they get from the council is the emptying of the bins. I know that's a generalisation, but it's certainly a perception that people have. And the change to this service will clearly affect everyone. But if there's a main benefit, if we can, you know, convince people of the benefits of the food recycling idea, then people will respond positively. They will not respond positively if there's a detrimental reduction. So, you know, my suggestion is that you change your approach, that you work in cooperation with people rather than attempting to coerce them into an approach by reducing the capacity of the green bins, and that we work for people to maximise our recycling bins. I think that's all.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Okay, Penny, would you like to respond to that?
Thanks, Stuart. As usual, we can set up the council and you can give a very comprehensive view of recycling and the problems that we have. But we need to be clear that this administration will not take any decisions without thinking it through completely. Working with other councils around the country, we're not the only people who are doing this, many other councils are doing this. So we look at the impact, and we will develop a full business case before we make any decisions. While we appreciate the Liberal Democrat motion, and I know that you've said you've got these 4,000 people in here, but we have had 10,000 people who've commented on the consultation. And we're still working our way through the consultation and making sure that we have a complete overview of what was meant from the residents. And mostly of them 10,000 people, it's positive comments, to be honest. So we're still analysing, reviewing all them comments. We're still working through and trying to produce a full business case, making sure that the entire project is designed to deliver the needs of the residents and to uphold what we're hoping to do with the environment and deliver for this pledge, the 50-50% pledge. But also heavily involved with the review that's going on with waste collection and recycling across the Liverpool City region, which is you touched on what we can and what we can't. So we're looking at that review and how this is going to impact on how we deliver waste for the whole of Merseyside. So we're working with the Liverpool City region. Anything that we do will be measured and will be fully considered, and everybody's views will be taken into account. So what I'm proposing for this cabinet is that we note the motion and consider it alongside the rest of the consultation feedback, the Liverpool City Region's review, and the ongoing full development of the business case, the full business case. So there's a lot to be considered. So all I'm proposing, if it's all right with you, Stuart, is that we note this and we just put it in as part of everything that's going on as we go forward.
Yeah, do you want to come back?
I suspect that if I was sitting in your place and processing what I was doing, I had been advised initially by officers that the business case would be available in October. Clearly, the feedback was there to be done. Then I was advised that it would be today. Officers have moved on with advising whether they're going to be bringing it forward, and I have got to the legal officer that I wasn't extend it into those sort of briefing things like that. So, thank you very much.
Sure, Sam.
I just wanted to make a comment, Stuart, on the thing you said about recycling all those plastic containers. I think it is, everybody says all this stuff you have to throw in a bin, which really, but I think it's worth pointing out that Cheshire West do, but they take a hit on it, a financial hit. It's not profitable, or it doesn't even touch its own face in terms of paying this way. It's subsidised by the authority. So, I just want us to be clear that's not something that we're discounting or we haven't looked at. Of course, that will be looked as part of the business review, but part of this wider Liverpool City Region waste review could be picking that up as well. So I think, it is a key point, because lots of people do say to me, why can't I put this in my bin? So something that will no doubt pick up there.
George, can I just add to that? Earlier on this year, our representative who sits on the Waste Authority, we actually made a motion to see if there was any way that we could change how we recycle all the plastics, and they've come back with a clear answer why they can't, but that doesn't mean that we've stopped. We are still asking them to find ways, and we're working through the higher management of the Merseyside Waste Authority to see if it can be done. It's nothing that you've said today hasn't been looked at. Believe you me, everything that we can do has been looked at with this. It's a very, very, very considerable project that's going to affect every single resident on the world. So nothing has been thought of and just wiped away. Anything that we will do will be a considered decision, and we will have evidence back to the decisions that we make. So, thank you for your input. And I've had a copy of a couple of emails I've been sent to you, so I know that not all your residents hold your opinions, because I've had a couple of emails sent to me saying how people disagree with the stance you're taking. So if we're going forward, and we'll just take it forward a step by step, and it will be considered, and it will be the right thing to do when we eventually do it.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed, Stuart. And Bernie, you just move that potato part of the overall.
Yeah, well, yes.
And I'll second that. Thank you. Item 7, getting back to open, climate change and the law act plan.
I welcome this report. The actions that we take on climate change is everybody's responsibility. It has to be done nationally, internationally, locally. Everybody has a part to play with this. You'll see from the report that the environment issues touches 17 out of our 20 pledges. It touches everything from transport, housing, public health, energy efficiency, recycling, litter, protecting the environment, all of that. I'm not going to go through all of them because you've all got the reports in front of you. The only one that I'd highlight, which echoes something that I said earlier on, if you look on page 55 of the report, there's the eco schools. We've got 64 eco-schools on the world, which is more eco-schools than any other borough in the country. We do some fabulous work with children, and if we're going to persuade people that they need to change their behaviour to protect the environment, it can be done in school. We're going to have a generation who are going to be educated to look after their environment. So the work we do in schools is very, very important. The Takeaway for Change project is doing lots of work with schools, so it's really, really, really exciting some of the stuff we do. And we've also been nominated for another national award for the work we're doing with our children. Hopefully we'll win, but it's Lynn Smooth who's working with all the schools. And just so that eco schools touch on everything. They touch on power and electricity, lights and transport, growing their own food, recycling food so they don't throw away food. They look at the whole spectrum of the environment. And on Wednesday here, there's going to be the project where the schools come together and they develop their thinking around all these projects. It's held once a year, and then one of the schools wins an award and takes a plaque away. So they'll be here in the town hall on Wednesday afternoon, I think, if anybody wants to pop in and have a look and see if the way it's being done. All I want you to do is note this report, note all the hard work that's going on.
track two cabins once a year for any updates or for anything to do. So thank you very much for being there and this work. Well done. Item 8. Sorry, is that good? Exception. No ways in business to be added this morning, so therefore I will move the exemption in item 11, exclusion of press from the public. Recommended that under section 100A4 of the public.
normally vote after it's seconded rather than before.
It says being seconded.
Oh, yeah, okay. Okay.
Would the public be now, please leave? Thank you.
Sorry, my point was you.